Yesterday, I promised you that we'd be transitioning to the blackboard today. However, you may have noticed at the bottom of the screen, there was a number that counts the number of slides there are. And that was also an estimate of the number of slides I thought I would get through yesterday. So that was slightly off the mark. So we'll continue with the computer today. But hopefully, we'll transition to the blackboard tomorrow. We'll see how it goes. But we did nicely cover yesterday just a review of what we know about essentially things that we know to be correct about the description of the universe that we've learned in the 20th century. And today what I want to talk about are what the central challenges are and what the big open problems are that are going to drive the development of our subject in the 21st century. Of course, some of these problems have been well appreciated already for a long time and have been used as a motivation for extending our picture of physics that I described last time. And there are a number of good ideas for how to proceed, but I think some of the core and sharpest problems involved here have not been touched and are really open, and I think will really be the questions, at least I think and I hope, that are going to drive the development of fundamental physics in the 21st century. So there's two issues. I alluded to both of them last time. One of them has to do with the fact that for a whole variety of reasons, we suspect that space-time is not a fundamental notion and has to emerge from more primitive building blocks. And the other one is that we don't have a good understanding, we don't have a good answer to an incredibly simple question: why is there a big macroscopic universe when the fundamental underlying quantum mechanical laws involve violent short-distance quantum fluctuations that seem to make it impossible to have a macroscopic universe? So these are the two classes of problems that I want to describe to you today. So let's start with the first one of them that has to do with the fact that there's probably no such thing as space-time fundamentally. So if we go back to the picture of the scales that we talked about last time, here is the size of the universe, 10 to the 28 centimeters. There's a weak scale, 10 to the minus 17 centimeters. These two bracket what we've actually probed by experiments or are probing with experiments. And then there's this much, much shorter distance scale around 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, the Planck length, which we said is associated with quantum mechanics and gravity. And in more detail, when quantum mechanics and gravity become important, we're going to see that the notion of space-time is doomed and has to be replaced by something else. This is yet another way of talking about what's going on at the Planck length. We essentially went through this argument last time, but if I take a pair of electrons, and we normally say the gravitational attraction between them is 42 orders of magnitude weaker than the electric repulsion, but what happens is I take those electrons and I really push them closer and closer together. You might think nothing happens. Gravity goes like an inverse square, electricity goes like, the electric force goes like an inverse square, so the ratio cancels, the distance cancels. But something new happens when you start forcing the electrons to be really close to each other. It's the same darn uncertainty principle over and over again. As you force the electrons to be closer and closer to each other, you've got to, just by the uncertainty principle, you've got to put a lot of energy in to hold them so close together. Okay, but then E equals mc squared, so the energy gravitates, and so the gravitational force of attraction between them starts increasing. That first starts happening at distances around 10 to the minus 11 centimeters, which is the Compton wavelength of the electron. Once you get to distances shorter than 10 to the minus 11 centimeters, the actual physical force between the pair of electrons gravitationally starts increasing. Okay. And then at some point, they become comparable to each other. Actually, in a little bit of detail, because alpha is weak, as we saw last time, it's around 1 over 137, the forces actually become comparable to each other, not quite at the Planck length, 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, but a little bit earlier, at around 10 to the minus 31 centimeters. At 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, gravity is strong as heck. Okay? It's strong at order one in every conceivable sense of the word. So that's one way of talking about what's going on at the Planck length that we talked about last time already. Gravity is getting strong at the Planck length. Okay? And again, very simple thought experiments. If we go back to my constantly badly drawn magnifying glass, we use this thought experiment before to learn that the vacuum is exciting, because if you look at it, you pop particles and antiparticles out of the vacuum. But now we're going to learn something else from this little magnifying glass, which is that the notion of space and time ceases to make sense as we go down to very short scales. So let's try to probe some distances and times which are shorter and shorter. Because of quantum mechanics and the uncertainty principle, we have to put more and more energy into a smaller and smaller region of space. In a world without gravity, there's, in principle, no limitation to the short distance scales that we can probe in this way. You just have to ask for lots and lots of money from bigger and bigger governments, and they'll let you build bigger and bigger accelerators, but nothing stops you, in principle, from probing arbitrarily short distances. When you have gravity, that changes. And it changes because at some point, you put so much energy into such a small region of space that you collapse that region into a black hole. So you're trying to learn what's going on in here, but you collapse a little region into a black hole, and no information from in there can get out. That first starts happening at around the Planck length, 10 to the minus 33 centimeters. Now let's say you get frustrated by that and say, damn, I'm going to try even harder with an even bigger accelerator, more powerful magnifying glass. What'll happen? Make an even bigger black hole. Your attempts to probe short distances are stymied by gravity. Okay? So that means that there's no, even in principle, way that we can probe distances and time that are short compared to the Planck length, the Planck time. And every time that's happened to us before in the history of physics, that meant that the concept that we're talking about is approximate. If we can't even in principle observe it, whatever we're talking about is approximate and has to emerge from more elementary ingredients or building blocks. But in this case, it's startling because the thing which has got to emerge from more primitive building blocks is space-time itself. And that calls into question what physics is even about. See, these are the sorts of questions that that are the really big ones in physics. The really big ones are the ones that change the very nature of what physics is supposed to be. Like when we went from classical to quantum, you know, the poor classical physicists in the 1850s thought the purposes of physics was to measure all the positions and velocities today and predict the future to infinite accuracy. Well, we just learned that's just not the way the world is. We have to redefine what physics is when we learned more about the world. Okay? And we're in a similar situation today. For 2,000 years, all of science, never mind physics, has been about describing how things happen in space and time as they move through time. And yet the whole notion of space-time doesn't seem to really make sense at a deep level. So this is a really massive conceptual challenge to us. How do we even make sense of what space-time is if it's fundamentally an approximate notion? And that's something that we'll talk a little bit about. Now, where are these questions important? There are some places where they're obviously important. For example, as we go back in the early universe, there are places where the curvatures approach the Planck scale. Or if we go near the singularity inside of black hole, again, there are places where the space-time curvature approaches near the Planck scale. And these are just places where our theories are crying out for mercy. They're begging. They say, please don't trust us anymore. We don't know what's going on. Full stop. There's just, the theory just breaks down, and they have the good manners to predict their own demise. They say, it just doesn't make sense anymore. We don't know what's going on. So if you ask the question, what happened before the Big Bang? It's very likely a nonsense question, because what's going on is as we approach the Big Bang, the very notion of time, and therefore before, ceases to make sense. The much bigger question is what replaces those notions. We don't know. But it's probably meaningless to ask the question, what came before the Big Bang?
So
okay.
You're saying that
did the concept make
sense?
Yes. Time and space, yes. Time and space, fundamentally, neither one makes sense. Neither one individually nor the combination, because since Einstein, since relativity, we know only the combination makes sense. Only space-time makes sense. Okay. Now, this is a rather common way of talking about the problem, but it's actually not the deepest aspect of the problem. You see, this way of thinking about it makes you think that the issues associated with quantum mechanics and gravity are only important at very tiny scales, close to the Planck length. And it might even make you think of something very, very naive, like a picture as you go to very, very short scales, somehow space-time is built out of atoms of space-time or something like that. Those ideas, it's very, very hard to make any sense of them. They probably don't make any sense. And part of the reason is, we could talk a lot about ideas that don't make sense, but part of the reason they don't make sense is that there's a much deeper aspect of the problem, which is not just localized at very short distances. There's a sense in which there is no, even macroscopically, there is no inside of a space-time to talk about in any precise sense at all. And this really goes back to a very important feature of quantum mechanics. So we're going to go through. We're going to go through a little. Just remembering a little recollection of what it takes to talk about precise observables in quantum mechanics. As we went from classical to quantum, we all know we lost an enormous number of things that we could talk about in the world. We went from a deterministic world to one we could only talk about probabilities. And yet, when we teach undergraduates quantum mechanics, we pat them on the head, and we tell them, don't get too worried, it's not so bad. You can still predict probabilities exactly. Okay, there's still something you can predict. Okay, we're going to go off and predict probabilities exactly. Great. So what does that take? Well, let's say you're trying to measure something about a system with some measuring device. I'm not talking about a theory. I'm not talking about Schrodinger's equation. I'm not talking about anything fancy for the moment. I'm just asking, what kind of precise observation can we make of that system? And any precise observations at all involve two infinities. That one of them we talk about a lot, and one of them is a little more tacit, but involves two infinities. One, we have to do the experiment infinitely often. That's fine, because if we want to measure a sharp probability, the theory is statistical in nature, we have to do the experiment infinitely often. The one that we talk about a little bit less is that you have to do the experiment with an infinitely large measuring apparatus compared to the system. The first one we talk about a lot because if you do the experiment n times, there's a statistical error that goes like 1 over square root of n. That's even practically important. So experimentalists will quote their statistical error when they tell you what's the results of their measurements. But the second one is also important. The second infinity is also important. If you want really precise observables, and I want to stress here, none of these things are practically relevant for almost any question, even, and forget about every life, even any question in ordinary physics, okay? Because especially the second error I'm talking about is so tiny that we normally don't care about it. But it's crucial conceptually. In exactly the same way as most times when a soccer player is kicking a ball, the uncertainty principle isn't relevant. They sure as heck know the position and velocity of the soccer ball accurately enough to score. But it's conceptually, crucially important that in fact you can only know one or the other, but not both. So we're going to be talking about a similar problem here. Now let me stress why it is that we have to do the experiment with an infinitely large apparatus. And there's many reasons for this. There are many words that you can associate with it. Let me give you one of the simple ones. Let's say I want to do an experiment that's going to measure, let's say, the g minus 2 of the electron, and I'm really, really good. I want to do it, measure it to 10 to the 40 decimal places. Okay? Great. So off I go. I do the experiment tons of times. I keep going. At around the 10 to the 10 to the 30th decimal place, I'm made out of 10 to the 30 things, okay? So at around 10 to the power of 10 to the 30, or e to the 10 to the 30, because I myself am a quantum mechanical system, there's a finite probability that I'll collapse into a cloud of dust, or that I'll tunnel out of the room, or that my brain will have a fluctuation, and even though it says on the counter 1 in the 10 to the 10 to the 30th decimal place, I write down 7, okay? So this is very important. In order to have perfectly sharp observations in quantum mechanics, the system has to be infinitely large. The error associated with it not being infinitely large is e to the minus n, where n is the number of things that it's made up, or 1 over the dimensionality of the Hilbert space of the system. Okay? Either one of those things is a good estimate for the error. And that's why we talk about it so little, because it's practically completely irrelevant, right? The statistical error, which is 1 over square root of n, is vastly more important than the statistical error that's e to the minus n. And yet it's there. This was a fact that was very well appreciated by the people who invented quantum mechanics, and even better appreciated since the understanding, modern understanding of decoherence and the way classical physics emerges from quantum mechanics and so on was established in the 1980s. But it's a fact of life about quantum mechanics. Precise observables involve, in the back of your mind, dragging around an infinitely large classical apparatus with you everywhere you go. Okay? In a world without gravity, there's nothing wrong with this. In a world with gravity, there is something wrong with this. And in fact, what's wrong with it is that we can't actually perform any measurements in a fixed-size room and actually get a perfectly sharp result out of it. Let's say I'm trying to do an experiment in this room. Okay. I can bring in resources from the outside. I can do anything I want, but I'm going to do the experiment in this room. Well, what's going to happen is I cannot make the apparatus infinitely big. As it has more and more pieces, it's going to get heavier and heavier. And at some point, it's going to get so heavy that it's going to collapse the whole room into a black hole. And when that happens, of course, we only have a finite amount of time to do the experiment before we're crunched. Okay? So I can't get sharp results. So this is really fascinating. I mean, we're going to talk about a little bit more, but it's a fascinating theme that's been permeating physics for the last 100 years, that we seem to be able to talk about less and less with precision. In a classical world, it was perfectly deterministic. We add quantum mechanics, okay, it's not deterministic anymore, but we still have lots and lots of observables that we can talk about, including any local observables anywhere. Now we add gravity and we lose even those. We lose local observables. We'll talk in a second about what we gain, what's left, but we lose local observables. Now let's try to get an estimate for the kind of imprecision that's involved with talking about local things. So I'm saying that there's no precisely defined local observables because of gravity. This is one of the famous slogans about quantum gravity. It's one of the deepest insights about putting quantum mechanics and gravity together. And often when I tell experimental colleagues there's no local observables, they say, so what the heck am I doing in my lab all day? And the answer is, you're doing the thing like that soccer player does, controlling position and momentum at the same time to score goals. It's perfectly fine, it's practically perfectly fine, but what you're doing does not correspond to something that can even in principle be measured to infinite accuracy. Okay? If you try to design an experiment to do any local experiment, there's an irreducible systematic error that you cannot, even in principle, reduce to zero. Okay? And so the quantity that you're talking about is fundamentally approximate, just like the position and momentum of the soccer ball, while practically important, is fundamentally approximate. Now let's try to get an estimate. If you know something about black hole entropy already, we could jump to that, but let's just go a little bit slowly, just so we see these things are very easy to understand. Okay? So I want to make an apparatus in this fixed size room, and I want it to have more and more pieces, more and more degrees of freedom to make it out of. Okay? So just naively, what's the most number of degrees of freedom that I could have sort of in this room? Well, if I wanted to have the most number of degrees of freedom possible, I mean, I could just put one little spin here, another little spin there, a little spin there. If you do that, you can count how much you get, and you can get an awful lot of degrees of freedom, but it's not as much as you could get. If you just think for a second, what would give you the most number of degrees of freedom you might imagine having in the room? The most number of degrees of freedom you would naively think is associated with thermal equilibrium. So let's actually kind of get a count for the number of degrees of freedom that we might be able to fill in this room by imagining that we're filling it with a ball of radiation that has some temperature T. Okay? Now, we could get more and more and more pieces by making the temperature higher and higher, but at some point there will be so much mass that will collapse a room into a black hole. So first, let's figure out when that happens. The energy density, just by dimensional analysis, is temperature to the fourth. The mass is temperature to the fourth r cubed. So gm over r comparable to 1 is when it would collapse into a black hole. Very good. From this little formula, we can see that tr to the fourth is r squared over g newton. That's the area of the room over g newton. And so we have a ball of gas that's just about to collapse into a black hole. Right at the moment that it's about to collapse into a black hole, its TR to the fourth is around the area in Newton's constant. Now, what is the entropy at this point? Well, the entropy density is just T cubed, again, just by dimensional analysis. So the total entropy is T cubed R cubed. And just using this formula, you see that the entropy goes like the area over G Newton to the power of 3/4. Now, if you've seen something about black holes before, you see that, this entropy that goes like area over G Newton, this is a magic important expression. It's the entropy of the black hole. And here we've actually learned something very nice. If you take a ball of gas and it's just about to collapse into a black hole, its entropy is minuscule compared to the ultimate entropy of the black hole itself. In fact, it goes like the area over G Newton. This is a big number. It's that to the 3/4, okay? Now, how do we keep going from there? Actually, you could be a little more clever now, because as it starts being collapsed into a black hole, you can start adding things to it. You see, here we're imagining that every sort of piece here is contributing to the energy, as the way it naively would if there was no gravity. But once you make a black hole, you can lower things towards it carefully and use the redshift of the black hole to decrease the amount that it contributes to the effective mass. And in so doing, you can actually, if you do it carefully, you can use this redshift to build things that have an entropy that get closer to this area over G Newton. But from just a simple counting already, you see there's something interesting and special about the area in units of the Newton constant. Okay? So E to the power of the area in Newton's constant seems to be an upper limit to the total number of degrees of freedom that we could talk about. Now, of course, as many of you know, in the 1970s, in the early 70s, from completely different arguments, people suspected that there should be an entropy associated with black holes. These arguments first arose purely classically. So people looked at black hole solutions with one black hole sitting here, another black hole sitting there, and they discovered that there were very interesting theorems, that if you took one black hole here, another black hole there, and they merged, that the resulting black hole that you got had an area that was greater than the sum of the areas of the two black holes that made it. And that, together with a variety of other arguments, started suggesting that there should be some kind of a notion of an entropy associated with a black hole that was proportional to its area. Okay. But there was still no sharp idea for what exactly it should be and what the constant of proportionality should be until Hawking came along. Hawking at first thought that the idea that the black hole should have an entropy is absurd, because anything that has an entropy, and a very large entropy, should be hot and should be radiating. And of course, black holes are black. But Hawking discovered his very famous and important effect that black holes radiate. And this is a picturesque way of talking about it, that close to the event horizon, you can have these quantum fluctuations out of the vacuum, particles and antiparticles popping in out of the vacuum. But if it's happening close to the horizon, one of the pairs can, by accident, end up on the wrong side and never come out, whereas the other one can come out. And so the presence of the horizon can take these quantum fluctuations in the vacuum and pull particles out of the vacuum to infinity, simultaneously decreasing the mass of the black hole. So just, again, by dimensional analysis, what could the temperature of the black hole possibly be? It can't be anything other than 1 over r, 1 over the size of the black hole. And that's the kind of typical sorts of quantum fluctuations which would, anyway. So that's all it could be just by dimensional analysis. But much more than dimensional analysis, you can really compute the black hole entropy in detail. And you find it's indeed proportional to the area. And there's a constant of proportionality, which is 1 over 4 g Newton. Now, so we saw a second ago that if you have a ball of gas that's just collapsing into a black hole, its entropy goes like area to the 3/4. So it's way tinier than the ultimate entropy of the black hole. That makes sense. You know, most of the degrees of freedom are going in whatever is crunching all this matter into the final black hole state. So we're exciting all kinds of degrees of freedom that we don't know about. in order to go up from this area to the 3/4 up to the final answer, which goes like the area. And in fact, the black hole is the object that has the maximum entropy for a given mass. Okay, so it's the most entropic object that you can have with a given mass. All right. And just something else that I should tell you is that this entropy also controls many other things. So if you have a black hole of a given mass, if it has a big mass, it has a large entropy. And it takes a long time for it to evaporate. It'll eventually evaporate, get smaller and smaller, and evaporate entirely. We'll come back to that in a second, but it takes a long time for it to evaporate. The time scale for evaporation in units of the size of the black hole is S, is the entropy. The number of quanta that it emits is S. So this entropy controls not just the entropy of the black hole, but also how long it lives and the number of quanta that it emits as it's evaporating. So now we can go back and have a more quantitative estimate for how much this idea of locality is screwed up. I say there's no local observables, so there's an irreducible error to any local observation I make in this room. What is the size of the error? It's of order e to the negative the area of the room in units of the Newton constant. Okay? Totally relevant practically, I'll say for the 100th time, but critical conceptually. Means that there's fundamentally no observations that I can make in this room which can even in principle be made arbitrarily accurate. It also tells you something else, which is technically interesting, that this violation of ideas of locality does not show up in any order of perturbation theory. If you imagine doing some kind of expansion in powers of G Newton, to all orders in G Newton, everything is perfectly fine. It's this fundamentally non-perturbative effect, something that goes like e to the minus 1 over G, which is where fundamentally the idea of locality is breaking down. Now, you might think this is a completely, let me just back up. Perhaps maybe I'll come to this at the end. Okay. Let me go back here. So what kind of observables are we left with? There are no local observables. There is one final class of observable that we can talk about. And we can't do measurements in a fixed size room, but what we can do is if there is some infinity in the space-time. If we can go to infinity, then we can do the following sort of thing. We can make the apparatus bigger and bigger and have it produce a bunch of particles here, another one produce a bunch of particles there. They can follow each other inside the space-time. They can bang into each other, do whatever they want to do, and go back out and be measured by infinitely big apparatuses at infinity on the other side. Okay? So if we can separate particles, if we can make if there is some boundary to the space-time at infinity, then that's where the observables are. Okay? Those are the things that can, in principle, be measured arbitrarily accurately. Now, that's good news to a particle physicist because, of course, this is the kind of thing, these are the sorts of observables that we talk about all the time in high-energy physics. They're scattering experiments. Okay? And so scattering experiments are things that can, in principle, be made exact. Now, for example, if we're doing the experiments at CERN, at the LHC, okay, that's not an experiment where it's literally infinitely big. You know, this ring is 27 kilometers around. It's not, it's plenty big, but it's not infinitely big. So there is an irreducible imprecision to any experiment we do at CERN, on the Earth, anything, okay, because of this effect. But those scattering processes are things that, in principle, if we made the experiment bigger and bigger, we made the accelerator bigger and bigger, we separated things more and more, we would reduce the error on it smaller to eventually zero. So the quantity that we're talking about that we measure in experiments is continuously connected to something that, in principle, we can measure perfectly accurately. On the other hand, if you do an experiment in a fixed size room, those observables are not continuously connected to things that we can, in principle, observe to arbitrary accuracy. Note, I'm not even talking about a theory yet. I'm just talking about what things are observable, what things are sharply observable that it would make sense to have a theory for. Okay? So before even talking about a theory, we should figure out what the output of the theory is supposed to be and how that output is going to be compared with experiment. All right, so the slogan here then is we went from classical to quantum, determinism to no determinism, but still a ton of local observables. Now you add gravity, even fewer observables. Right? Now the only observables we have live at the boundary of the space-time. Now, you might think that the effect that we're talking about, this violation of this notion of locality that goes like e to the minus area over g Newton, that yes, this is very conceptually important, but boy, oh boy, oh boy, nobody cares. Absolutely nobody cares. When would it possibly be important? After all, it's only going to be important near the Planck length, and not even as any power as you go down to larger distances. This is an exponentially tiny thing. Already at 100 times the Planck length, these are effects that are e to the minus 10,000 in size. So who's going to care about it at all? Well, that's why it's so interesting that there are situations where even very, very low energy experiments, if you don't realize that this notion of locality is compromised at this tiny level, very, very low energy experiments you could get completely the wrong answer to if you think in terms of local physics. So there are situations where this can happen. The most famous situation, which stimulated a lot of the thinking in the subject for the entire decade of the 80s into the early 90s, is the black hole information paradox. So here the problem is, imagine you have a black hole sitting there, or a star is collapsing to form a black hole. But anyway, as it's collapsing in, you know, you throw your laptop in and your books in, if you read books anymore. I don't know that you guys know what books are. But there's this thing where there's words in it, lots of pages. Anyway, you throw them in, and you throw laptops in, you throw your computers in. Okay, it all goes into the black hole, and the stuff behind the horizon, none of it can come out. All of it's permanently trapped behind the horizon, but the black hole is gradually evaporating. All these Hawking quanta come out, and apparently we're just left with nothing with the thermal bath of radiation that's coming out. So all the information about what was in the books and the laptops and everything is just completely gone. Okay. And that cannot be. That cannot be compatible with the principles of quantum mechanics. Principles of quantum mechanics are, in principle, certainly time reversible. We should be able to reconstruct from the final state what the initial state is and vice versa. So this was a very major paradox. It was an incredible insight of Hawking's to put his finger on this question. When you burn a book, it's different. When you burn a book, it's apparently thermal, but there are fine correlations between all the particles that are coming out. And if you measure all those fine correlations, you can reconstruct the state. You might think that maybe something like that's going on here too, that maybe if you just do Hawking's calculation more correctly, there would be fine correlations that would let the information come back out. But here's where it really matters that there is a horizon there. It's not like a book where there isn't, where a burning book or the proverbial lump of coal. It's not like that. There's no horizon. Here there is a horizon, and you can really argue very robustly, independently of any details of how you do the calculation, that there's absolutely no way. If the physics is local, if evolution is local, there's absolutely no way that the final state contains correlations in it that lets you reconstruct what went in. Okay, that's why this was such an important paradox, and that's why it was a true inspiration for Hawking to put his finger on this question, because it's really a very sharp place where the usual notion of locality leads you to an apparently absurd conclusion. So Hawking suggested initially that this is actually what happened, and in a sense it was a conservative statement, because if you just assume local evolution makes sense, which at scales much, much larger than the Planck length is surely a sensible thing, then this seems to be the inevitable conclusion. But that's not the right answer. What we now believe the right answer is, is that, in fact, it is like a lump of coal. The information is there in very fine correlations. And the reason that can happen is that this notion of locality isn't actually correct. We don't actually have locality fundamentally. It's violated by these tiny, tiny effects. But these tiny, tiny effects can sometimes matter. So I'm not going to give a whole talk on the resolution of the black hole information problem. And part of the reason is that while it's largely understood how it works, and that the answer is definitely correct, that there is no, it's perfectly nice, normal quantum mechanical evolution, the fine details for how it works have not been, I think, completely understood yet. But anyway, but this is, gives you a rough idea for why it's even possible. I told you that there are these minuscule corrections to the notion of locality that go like e to the minus s. Okay. How could that possibly be important for any question? It can only be important if somewhere in the question you're asking, there's an e to the plus s somewhere. Okay. I mean, something has got to make up for this ridiculously minuscule violation of the idea of locality. But it turns out that actually, in the question of trying to decide whether the information does come out of the black hole or not, you are implicitly making of order e to the plus s measurements. The reason is, in order to decide whether the information came back out or not, you have to capture all of the quanta that come out and look at their state. Let's say you only capture half of the quanta that came out, or a tenth of the quanta that came out. Then in a totally garden variety state, big state with many degrees of freedom, if you're only looking at a tenth of all the degrees of freedom there are, of course it's not going to look like those tenths, that part of what you're looking at is pure. That part is going to be entangled with all the other things that you're not looking at. In order to even decide whether the final state is pure, you have to study all of the quanta that come out. I told you that roughly s quanta come out, so that's of order e to the s measurements that you have to make. And that at least lights something up, that it's possible that this minuscule violation of locality, which is of order e to the minus s, is being amplified by asking this very, very, very precise question. You're asking a highly precise question of all s states that are coming out. But it's striking because this is a situation where even at very, very low energies, in principle, this violation of locality is hugely significant and leads you to radically different conclusions about what the final state looks like. Okay. So this idea that that there's no local observables, all the observables live on the boundary, that there's no locality fundamentally, it has teeth. It has real consequences, and it sometimes has to be very, very special questions in order to amplify these effects, but they can show up even macroscopically. So this shows why the idea that the problems with quantum mechanics and gravity are just localized down to the Planck length is not correct. Okay? It's really this more deep problem that there's no local observables at all. And this is a situation where that fact really is important at order one. Okay, now these were lots of motivations in different thought experiments that people pursued through the early 90s, especially string theorists. If I had much, much longer, I would spend a lot longer on this subject. This would be a subject for a lecture series all by itself. But the culmination of all these developments, really, in my mind, and in the minds of most of us, the culmination of 20th century physics, theoretically, is this correspondence, this incredible correspondence that was discovered between theories of quantum gravity in d plus one dimensions and quantum field theory in d dimensions. So if we go back to our basic ideology, the basic ideology is that because of quantum mechanics and gravity, there are no local observables. So all the observables are out there on the boundary. You might think that that's true, but the only way to calculate what they are is to still follow through what happens in the inside of the space-time and have them go back out. That doesn't make much sense if the inside of the space-time isn't there. So surely, if the ideology, if you want to push it to its natural conclusion, there should be some way of calculating these observables without ever talking about the inside of the space-time at all. And for a particular class of space-times that look, as you go out to the boundary, like anti-de Sitter space, we understand very precisely how this works now. Okay, so if the geometry looks like, as you go out to the outside, looks like anti-de Sitter space, so the geometry looks like a tin can, then, so inside we have this nice negatively curved space. The curvature could be as tiny as we like. The curvature could be negative 10 billion light years. If we didn't know about cosmology, our own world could well have looked something like that, okay? A tiny negative curvature. Then the idea is that the only precise observables, again, are localized on the boundary. So you can go out to the boundary, you can ping things on the boundary, you can hit them and measure how they're correlated with each other. Okay, you ping them here, they go in, they come out to somewhere else. And all of those observables, which you think are associated with the theory that has gravity in it, this warped space in it on the inside, maybe it has strings, it has extra dimensions, all of the structure we normally associate with quantum gravity, that's all completely equivalent to a theory where there's none of that. It's just a good old-fashioned theory of particles, just like quarks and gluons, close cousins of quarks and gluons that live on the boundary. No gravity, no strings, no extra dimensions, just good old-fashioned quarks and gluons, good old-fashioned quantum field theory. So this is a completely astonishing equivalence. These are two sets of ideas that seemed to not only not be related to each other, but be at odds with each other. Quantum field theory on the one hand, and putting together quantum mechanics and gravity on the other hand. And certainly, people thought that the attempts to make sense of quantum gravity were going well beyond quantum field theory. Had to involve radically new ideas not contained in quantum field theory. And we see that, in fact, it is quantum field theory. Just not in the same space. In fact, if you want to do a fancy quantum gravity in a fancier, higher dimensional space, it's equivalent to a good old-fashioned quantum field theory on the boundary of that space. We'll go through a little bit of the dictionary for how this works in a second, but I just cannot emphasize how important this is. And so this is also the first example we have of this idea of emergent space-time in action. Okay. There is emergent space. The fundamental theory doesn't have any of this inside in it. There's no gravity in it fundamentally. But gravity and strings and the inside of the space and extra dimensions and everything else is just the consequence of the dynamics of this good old-fashioned particle theory that lives on the boundary. So, of course, the most important things about this idea are the physics that it involves. But there's also a wonderful sociological consequence of it, which is that in the 1980s, there were different camps in fundamental physics. There were people who worked on string theory, the people who worked on particle physics and quantum field theory, and somehow they weren't the same groups, or they seemed to be doing different things, and there was some sociological tension between them. And now we know that they're exactly the same thing. So there's just one subject, the collection of all good ideas in theoretical physics for the last 40 years, and people have been looking at different aspects of it. There are people who look at other things not contained in the good ideas in theoretical physics, but we're not talking about them today. Okay. Of course, this is when the interactions are weak on this side, corresponds to when the interactions are strong on the other side, and vice versa. So there's a reason why it took people so long to realize that these were actually different aspects of the same thing, but they are different aspects of the same thing. I said it's a beginning of a realization of this ideology that space-time should be emergent, but it has not gone all the way yet. We'll come back to it in a second. But very, very important is that the time that flows here, there's one uniform time. There's a time at the edge of the tin can. There's a time in the middle of this tin can. And the time is flowing up everywhere, the same time. So time is not emergent in this picture. Space is emergent, gravity is emergent, strings are emergent, extra dimensions are emergent, but time is not emergent. That's good, because there's no way in heck we would have discovered it if time had to be emergent too. Okay? What we found is that two otherwise normal physical theories with normal language, normal words. In fact, the two theories that were handed down to us from the early part of the 20th century, quantum mechanics elevated to quantum field theory on one side, relativity elevated to GR on the other side, but two normal physical theories are equivalent to each other. No, Lorentz invariance is perfectly fine on both sides as well. In fact, what happens, I'll just answer this question, what happens is that the inside theory has a higher dimensional Lorentz invariance. Well, it's not Lorentz symmetry because it's anti-de Sitter space, but it's the isometries of anti-de Sitter space are the symmetries of the bulk theory in the simplest case. And the boundary theory is not just the garden variety Lorentz invariant theory, but is conformally invariant, which is a bigger symmetry than just good old-fashioned Lorentz symmetry. And those two symmetries are the same. The conformal group and the space of isometries of anti-de Sitter space are actually the same. That's one of the very, very early hints that this correspondence was could possibly make sense. Yeah. Now, the progress in physics never loses old ideas. So it's never going to be that, I mean, people imagine that it might be you have to violate Lorentz invariance or do something to make sense of quantum mechanics and gravity. There's no way it's going to work like that. 400 years of physics have taught us that the old ideas never go away. The constraints just get stronger. The theories just get more special. Not once have we lost something. And there's not a single indication that we're going to lose something in any of the things that we've been talking about here. Okay. So let me just give you a little bit of an idea for how this correspondence works. So first of all, the most dramatic aspect of this correspondence is that it seems that you have two theories. You know, one theory that's a good old-fashioned theory of quarks and gluons. Okay, the interactions are strong. But a good old-fashioned theory of quarks and gluons that lives in four dimensions. The other theory is gravity and stuff like that in five dimensions. So first of all, how can you possibly encode what the fifth direction is? I mean, let's say I have a little particle here and a little particle there, different points in the fifth dimension. How is that fact encoded in a theory that just lives on the boundary? And it's encoded in the following beautiful way. It's encoded in scale size on the boundary. So if you have a little particle here, it has some energy, right? That, from the point of view of this, of the theory that has the inside and gravity and everything else, if you have a particle sitting there, from the point of view of the theory that doesn't have it, that is reflected as some little blob of energy of some size. Just an excitation of these quarks and gluons that has some characteristic size. If you move this further away, the blob just gets bigger. Okay, but the position in this fifth direction is reflected in just the size, the scale size of the object. That's one piece of the correspondence. There are other remarkable pieces. I mean, we can really go through everything because there's a detailed dictionary, but let me just give you more of the qualitative pictures. Let's say we have two particles here in the middle of the space, and they're gravitationally attracting each other, just good old Newton's law, just gravitationally attracting each other in the middle of the space. Okay? Gravity. Okay? How is that gravitational attraction between these two particles? How is that encoded in this theory that just lives on the boundary? Well, that's the answer is that there's one little blob of energy here, there's another little blob of energy there, and these two blobs of energy polarize the vacuum, quantum mechanically polarize the vacuum, and that gives rise to an attractive interaction between them. It's essentially exactly the same physics that gives rise to the van der Waals force, which is a force between neutral objects. You know, two hydrogen atoms attract each other because each one polarizes the other one, and there's some effective net attraction between them. Essentially, the analog of that van der Waals effect for just these quarks and gluons gives an attractive interaction between these blobs, which is exactly, in quantitative detail, precisely what looks like the classical Newtonian attraction between them inside the space. So this correspondence would have thrown Einstein for a loop. He hated quantum mechanics, and here we are making this whole relativistic space, gravity, curvature, all of that stuff is actually directly a result of highly quantum mechanical effects from the point of view of a theory that doesn't even have gravity in it. Okay. So it's the ultimate insult from his point of view. Okay. So the theory that he hated is actually supreme, and his theory is some emergent approximation out of it. I really hope, to those of you who haven't seen this before, this should completely blow you away. This is just astonishing. This is not some little detailed thing. This is absolutely mind-blowing stuff. Finally, this comes back to the question we were talking about a second ago. So everything on one side has a representation on the other side. So let's say in this space I have a black hole sitting there in the middle of the space. In the middle of this tin can, I have a black hole. Actually, I drew it badly because I had time going up here, so this makes it look like there's a black hole that's starting and ending. This should have been like a cylinder like that. Sorry, I drew it badly. Okay, so the black hole sitting there forever. Okay, what does a black hole sitting there forever look like from the point of view of this theory on the boundary? Just corresponds to heating up these quarks and gluons. You heat them up so there's a hot plasma of quarks and gluons. That's what black holes are. So what is the process of throwing things together, making a black hole, and having them evaporate look like? Looks exactly like, you know, taking two particles, throwing them together really hard. They thermalize and make some thermal soup of stuff. For a while, it looks like that thermal soup of stuff. When it looks like that thermal soup, from the point of view of the interior theory, it looks like you've made a black hole. But then that thermal soup evaporates, and everything comes back out, and that corresponds to the black hole evaporating, and everything come back out. But because the whole theory is manifestly, beautifully quantum mechanical, the fundamental theory doesn't even have gravity in it. It's this lower dimensional theory of just quarks and gluons. Strongly interacting quarks and gluons, there's clearly no loss of information. Okay? But it's because the fundamental theory doesn't even have the inside of the space-time. And that's that connects with the previous discussion that we were having. Okay. So that, I think, that's the very, very best picture we have so far for how to put, for what this idea of emergent space-time should mean. And as I mentioned, it has not gone all the way. Okay. But it's pretty damn good. So let's actually pause for a second before talking about the things that are missing. Let's summarize for a second the things that are at least in principle understood now. Because there's a whole bunch of things that are in principle understood which used to be thought of as the holy grail for putting together quantum mechanics and gravity. Okay, in the 1980s, the holy grail for putting together quantum mechanics and gravity was to find an answer to the question for what's going on with gravity at short distances. So you could ask a nice sharp question. If you scatter two gravitons at very high energies, what actually happens? You know, what happens? What comes out? All of these short distance questions about gravity clearly don't care if the curvature of the space looks like an inside of a tin can or it looks like anything else. If in this room I wanted to collide two gravitons at very, very high energies and see what happened, I wouldn't have to know I wouldn't even have to measure whether the curvature was weakly negative, weakly positive. All of these local questions don't care about this global properties of the space-time. So all of these local questions can in principle be asked in this kind of setup where the universe globally looks like a tin can. And so they all have, in principle, an answer contained in the strong interactions of this quantum field theory. That doesn't mean that we know the answers. It's a strongly interacting quantum field theory, and we don't know how to solve those. But we know how to do them in principle. We can, in principle, simulate them on the computer. There's no conceptual problem with imagining that gives a complete answer to any question that we might like to ask. We'll come back to this later in the lectures, a new set of very important questions, which is an outgrowth of all these things, is that we really need to understand much more deeply what quantum field theory is. It's clearly not just what we thought it was, handed down to us from the 1930s. It's a vastly richer and more interesting structure, and trying to understand it more deeply is going to teach us an enormous amount in the 21st century. But at least for this kind of question, in principle, any local question about gravity, what used to be thought of as the Holy Grails 30 years ago, are answered in this kind of framework. So what kind of questions are not answered? The real mysteries are now global, not short distance questions. The real mysteries are associated with the very long distance questions. And this is really good, because these were always the deepest and most challenging problems about quantum mechanics and gravity anyway. And it's good to see that they're taking center stage as they should. The real problem has to do with the fact that our universe on very large scales does not look like this static tin can. We have cosmology, right? We have an expanding universe. So we extrapolate backwards, plausibly a Big Bang or some kind of curvature singularity in our past. It's expanding out as we go into the future. So time is clearly important. Time it's not just static. Time is something which is different in our real universe than in this toy example that we understand so well with where the geometry is that of a static tin can. But it's much, much worse than that, since we've discovered that we live in an accelerating universe. And this last slide here is really putting in one place, I think, all of the very, very hardest conceptual problems that we have to deal with, just in one spot. So not only is there an expanding universe, there was a Big Bang in the past somewhere, or some kind of curvature singularity in the past, which we need to make sense of. But even putting that aside, even today in our universe, the fact that it's accelerating brings us to a real set of conceptual, really, crises. Again, there are hardly of any practical relevance if you just want to go around doing low-energy physics. No problem. But that's not what we're talking about. We're asking questions of principle. So here I am. There is a universe that's accelerating. That means that there's a constant rate at which the universe is doubling in size. And so galaxies that are out there are getting blown apart from us at a fixed rate. So that means that far enough out, there are objects, stars, galaxies, whatever, where any light that's emitted from them will never make it to us. It'll never make it to us just because there's more space being created between them and us at a uniform rate, such that the light just keeps traversing some distance, but it'll just never, ever make it to us. Okay? We had this discussion with some of the students yesterday, but that means that if we look out at the universe now, the doubling time, the expansion rate is doubling, the universe is doubling in size, let's say every 10 billion, 15 billion years or so. But it means that roughly what we see out there now in the universe today is everything we're ever going to see. Okay? And in fact, if we wait hundreds of billions of years, thousands of billions of years, even some of the nearby galaxies will get sucked away from us. And it'll just be our little lonely galaxy. And even the cosmic microwave background will get diluted as the universe expands. So a long, long time from now, there'll just be a little lonely little galaxy. It would be very hard to imagine that those astronomers would even discover anything about cosmology. It would look like a very different universe than ours does. But anyway, we're thankfully not them, so we can think about these things easily. But more importantly, conceptually, it means that there is a finite, enormously large, 10 to the 10 to the 120 is the total number of is the total number of things that we could imagine making things out of. Okay. Enormously large, but still finite number of degrees of freedom accessible to any observer in our accelerating universe. That means that the infinity that we needed in order to make precise quantum mechanical observables is just not possible in an accelerating universe. Okay? It's this old thing that quantum mechanics forces you to have these infinitely large apparatuses in order to talk about anything with perfect precision. And we saw that as we keep going, we lose things that we can talk about. right? So because we add gravity, we can't talk about local observables, but there are some observables we can still talk about. We can still make infinitely big apparatuses and send them out to the boundaries of the space-time. Okay? We can't even do that anymore because we can't make any infinitely big apparatuses at all. In this accelerating universe, there's a finite, huge number of degrees of freedom, but that means there's no way of separating in any precisely sharp way what's system and what's apparatus. Okay? So that's the zeroth order, huge conceptual paradox. What are the correct observables? What should we even talk about? What should a theory that would explain this accelerating universe, what should even be the output of that theory? What are the correct observables? Now, I think this is the first time this has happened to us in the last 100 years, or since the development of quantum mechanics, that we have a set of questions that the theoretical framework that we have, quantum mechanics and relativity, but particularly quantum mechanics, does not allow us to ask certain questions, or doesn't tell us even what's legal, what we can talk about. Remember, we've said a number of times that as we keep learning more, we find out there's fewer and fewer things to talk about. There are fewer and fewer observables. That might have depressed people. It did depress classical physicists a lot that the world wasn't deterministic. But there has been a remarkable silver lining to the fact that there are fewer and fewer things to talk about. The fact that there are fewer and fewer observables is what makes it possible for the phenomenon that are actually out there to actually be unified and be different aspects of the same thing. It's a flip side of the fact that there's many, many fewer things to talk about. See, as we went from classical to quantum, the universe wasn't deterministic, it was probabilistic. That's exactly what made it possible for waves and particles to be the same thing. Okay? It's a flip side. As we add gravity now and we see, there's no local observables at all, that's so terrible. All we have are these crappy things at the boundary. Okay, but that's what makes it possible for a theory of quantum field theory to be the same as a theory of quantum gravity. There's always this flip side. We lose observables, but we gain unification of the things that are left. It's almost inevitable. If there are fewer things to talk about, the things that are left have got to be more closely related to each other than they were before. The problem is now, for the first time, we seem to have nothing left to talk about with any precision, with precise precision. And this is why this is such an important conceptual paradox. Okay? I think many people view this as the central and hardest problem in fundamental physics today. In this accelerating universe, how do we make sense of it? Not how do we make sense of it, what's making the universe accelerate. That's a cosmological constant. Never mind. That anyone who tells you otherwise is selling you something, typically an experimental program, you know. But it's just a cosmological constant. Chances are very, very good that it's just a cosmological constant. Okay? That's not the mystery. The mystery are these conceptual ones. How do we even talk about what physics is supposed to mean in an accelerating universe? I don't know, but it's clear that there are two things that have to go into making sense of this. Well, it's most certainly clear that the one thing we have to understand a lot better is the idea of emergent space-time. And the time part has got to play a key role now, okay? We went about as far as we could with the ideas that were handed to us in the 20th century. The quantum field theory and general relativity, ordinary physical systems of the time that turn out to be different aspects of the same thing. But now we really need something really, really new. Okay? We have to understand where even time comes from. That's one thing. And it's possible, this I will not say as strongly, but it's certainly possible, it has never been true before, but I think it's the first time now where it's at least possible that we need an extension to our notion of what quantum mechanics is. Notice that I'm not saying quantum mechanics is wrong, okay? It's not wrong. The problem isn't that quantum mechanics is wrong. The problem is that the usual way of thinking about quantum mechanics just seems inadequate. It doesn't leave us with anything to talk about at all, okay? So I don't know what there is to talk about, if anything, but this is why this is such a hard problem. It seems that perhaps there's got to be some extension to our usual way of thinking about quantum mechanics that allows us to make sense of the whatever it is that we're allowed to talk about in this sort of picture. Okay? So the second set of problems, as I said, this I'm a little less sure of. This is almost a given. and that we really need to understand what the idea of emergent space-time means, and in particular, what time is. All right, well, as you can see from the bottom of my slides, I continued not to get through my first lecture today. So let's just leave it at that. And tomorrow, we will take up the second big set of questions about very big zeroth order problems that we need to understand, which are related to this question of why there is a macroscopic universe. And of course, one of the wonderful things about physics is that you can't divide big problems up from each other. And it's very likely that many of these things are related. And we'll actually see that. It's some of the problems that are involved in this also deeply mystifying question of why there is a macroscopic universe are very likely going to take us back to having to understand properly the first set of things that we talked about here. All right, thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Nima, again. So, questions?
Okay, I risk to show that I understood nothing, but still I ask. Actually, the special relativity, one important and maybe most important message was that time and space somehow are similar, and that which actually broke down the conception separately of time and separately of space. And somehow it gave different meaning to dynamics, because this is one thing. The other thing was, and what you seem to show us is that, once again, we have some distinction between space and time, because you are saying that space is emerging and time is not. Right.
In a way, that's completely compatible with relativity. So it's...
Could you comment maybe once again about how, what do you mean by this distinction, or whether it exists or not?
Space-time are treated on an equal footing in relativity, but there is clearly a difference between time and space. I mean, time goes forward, we can't go back in time, can move around in space. Right, so there is causality, yes, that's right. I don't know. That's a very interesting comment that maybe has something to do with something. But it's not normally what we talk about when we talk about causality, right? I mean, it's just hardwired. Time goes forward, and we can move around in space. So time and space can be mixed, but they're not the same thing. And so what we see is in this geometry, there is a time that flows from minus infinity to infinity. And that time is the same on the edges of the tin can that is on the inside of the tin can. So in that sense, the time of this fundamental theory that lives on the boundary is the same as this emergent theory that lives inside. They both have time. As I explained towards the end, we probably need to do better than that, and even need a theory that doesn't have time in it fundamentally, whatever that means.
Time and space by causality.
Yes, that's right. Time and space are just distinguished by causality to begin with. That's right.
Where this causality is from.
Right. Although, if we understand emergent time, presumably we're going to have to understand what it is that makes it look like time and not like space. So it's probably part of that question. Yes, sorry.
Yeah, about the last big puzzle that you raised. Is that related to the notion or the assumption that any information storage, information that is stored is somehow gravitating in some sense?
Yes, and that's a very, very deep aspect of all of this.
And is that clear, actually, or...?
Well, I'll answer your question in two parts. If we take any kind of normal matter that we know, including matter that we can imagine, you know, as simple extensions of the kinds of things that we see, they have the remarkable property very obvious property, but still remarkable, that it just adds up. Gravity just adds up. Nothing you can do about it. You can't shield gravity. We can shield other forces, but we can't shield gravity. And it's this fact that you can't shield gravity that then gives us this inevitable connection with the measuring apparatus that we cannot decouple from the system that we're studying. Okay? So if we try to do the experiment in a finite size room, because no matter what we have, whatever we have, whatever degrees of freedom we have, they gravitate, we can't decouple system from apparatus, unless we go out to the boundary, and then sometimes we can't even do that, like in this accelerating universe, we can't even do that. Okay? Now, it's conceivable, and people have played around theoretically with ideas that allow you to have more exotic forms of matter. And if you have these more exotic forms of matter, then at least it's theoretically possible in the sense that you write down equations and it doesn't immediately tell you, give you a red light and tell you to stop because it has some terrible problem or an instability or some horrendous, obvious difficulty. Actually, most times you try to build matter like this, you find that it immediately tells you to stop and tells you not to go there. But there are more clever constructions you can come up with that allow you to at least imagine forms of matter that would allow you to shield gravity without it being completely obviously stupid. Okay. What's interesting is that when you look at those theories in more detail and try to see if they make sense in the presence of black holes or they make sense in the presence of an accelerating universe, you find they very likely don't make sense. So on the one hand, I told you there aren't any local observables. On the other hand, we have, for instance, the fact that we have black holes. Black holes have an entropy. They radiate. They have a consistent thermodynamics. And these two facts are very closely tied to each other. The fact that there's no local observables is very closely tied to the fact that we have decent horizon thermodynamics. And all these funny theories that would allow you to shield shield against gravity, as far as I know, they all screw up in a big way any reasonable thermodynamic interpretation of horizons. So it's a sort of detailed answer to your question. If you try to have things where you can shield things gravitationally, the most straightforward ways of doing it are completely dead. They're horrible, horrible theories, horribly inconsistent, unstable. There are incarnations that a number of us, even people in this room, have worked on that are not so bad, but they have some horrible sickness that are lurking in their heart nonetheless. Okay, and the sickness is always the same. It's really this deep consistency between horizons and thermodynamics that allows you to associate an entropy with horizons is what is in very close harmony with the absence of local observables. And if you can screw up, if you can allow local observables to exist, for example, by making apparatuses bigger and bigger and shielding them with negative gravitational energy, exactly the same systems also completely screw up interpretations of horizon thermodynamics. So it's a long answer, but the punchline is no. Okay, there's no way any collection of degrees of freedom inevitably gravitate, and you cannot shut that off. It's a deep fact about gravity. It's a deep fact about what makes gravity consistent, even roughly consistent. Never mind that this much more detailed or and deeper level.
Yeah. You have supposed when you have written about quantum gravity in D plus one dimension is equal to the quantum field theory in D dimension, you have supposed that the string theory is the right theory to describe the quantum gravity.
Nope. I did not suppose that at all. You see, this is one of the wonderful things. It's really a great thing about this fact that string theory and particle physics are the same thing. We don't have to have any of these discussions anymore. It's not like there is string theory and there is other theories. String theory is just true. String theory is true because string theory is field theory. Field theory is string theory. There's one structure. There's one structure that we don't understand very well. No, I mean, this is not a polemic statement. It's really an honest statement. It's that string theory and field theory are the same thing. The astonishing thing here, the absolutely astonishing thing here, is that you can write down a completely ordinary field theory, and a field theory has in it things that look like gravity and extra dimensions and strings in some limit. There are other field theories that don't look like they have strings. Okay? It's possible. The really deep insight here is that is this basic correspondence that what's going on inside is completely captured with what's going on the walls. And that insight, by the way, goes back to the 1960s. I didn't say the word holographic principle. I could have said the word holography at a number of junctures here. But this goes with the basic idea that the observables live on the boundary. But actually, this insight that the real observables live on the boundary at infinity is much older than what people normally call the holographic principle. This is something that goes back to Bryce DeWitt and Roger Penrose in the 1960s, who understood the point extremely well. It's a very deep, very important fact about quantum mechanics and gravity that the essential observables live on the boundary. The new idea is that because the observables only live on the boundary, the exact theory should only live on the boundary as well. Okay? And so that's new. But then you give examples where it's true, examples where you can study it in enough detail that you can really see that it's true. That's what the amazing thing is now. Okay, that we could have skipped the entire intermediate history and imagined that someone just had this spectacular insight to just imagine what it looks like if I took this this Yang-Mills theory, the supersymmetric Yang-Mills theory at very strong coupling. They somehow magically solved it, they put it on a computer, and they would find that all of its predictions look just as if there is an extra, there's warped space, these extra dimensions, strings, and all sorts of things like that. They'll all just be outputs. None of it would be an input, fundamentally, into what describes the theory. So So I also didn't talk about the other aspects. There are many other things that we could talk about associated with string theory. Which has to do with the 1980s idea of what this unification was supposed to be about. That in our space-time, we have gravity, we have the strong force, the weak force, all these other guys, and they're going to be unified in a cookie-cutter fashion into some pie with a triangle here for E&M and a triangle there for gravity and a triangle for something else. That was also an idea that people pursued. And that idea, that 1980s idea of unification, it's still possible. It's still, and string theory is still, as far as I'm concerned, is the best idea we have for it. But it seems wildly implausible now, to most people, certainly seems wildly implausible to me, that there's going to be one way the world could look like at large distances, which has a sort of cookie cutter sort of unification. Instead, we have this famous fact that if we think about string theory as this big theoretical structure, it has bazillions of solutions. People throw around the number 10 to the 500 all the time for some reason. There was early estimates gave the number 10 to the 500. It could be 10 to the 1,000 or 10 to the 10,000. It doesn't even matter. Gargantuan number of solutions. Each one of those solutions could look roughly like a world like ours, but with different gauge groups, different particle content, and so on. Okay? So if someone had the dream from the 80s of having this cookie-cutter picture into one thing, that seems wildly implausible. But it seems, people argue about that, and they have polemic debates about that a lot. But if you were not around in the 80s, you don't care so much. And I certainly don't care so much, because the kind of unification that we're getting now is so much deeper and so much more remarkable than what they could have imagined. You see, first of all these different 10 to the 500 worlds are actually the same thing. I mean, that's just completely astonishing. And then never mind the fact that the entire theoretical structure, it's not like we have to take gravity and then add it in this cookie-cutter way, that in fact gravity and gauge theory are different aspects of the same thing. That's massively more interesting than this, at least to me, it's massively more interesting than this chop up the triangle into different pieces, a picture of unification. Okay? So now, it does leave you with the question, if you wanted to test that idea of the cookie cutter picture of unification, then the only way to do that, to see if there's really strings there, is to go to very, very short distances near the Planck length and see what's going on there. That's always been the case about trying to make sense of quantum gravity. There was a hope in the 1980s, a hope that the answer would be unique so that even without going there, you would predict everything else at low energies and measure it. Okay, that hope, there's a very, very, very slim chance that that hope is still right. I think most of us think that that hope just seems wildly, wildly implausible. Now, you may be depressed about that. Some people are depressed about it, but certainly, as I said, most of us who weren't around in the 1980s don't care. I mean, the actual truth is radically more exciting, at least to me, than what that picture, even the sort of the loftiest thing that picture could accomplish is not as exciting as what we're actually learning, as far as I'm concerned.
That's a good point to stop the question. So unless there's, you have a question, okay.
Sir.
Would there be any significant change in this mapping between strings and traditional particle interpretations if new experimental results come up like CPT violation?
Things like CPT violation just prove that the framework of quantum field theory is wrong. Okay, so absolutely. I mean, that CPT violation, I mean, of course, you have to be very, very careful because there's all sorts of matter lying around that you don't know about might look like CPT violation. But if you're convinced there was fundamental, in the vacuum, fundamental CPT violation, then we throw out the entire framework of local quantum field theory. So there are things like that. You know, violations of Lorentz invariants, you know, the famous superluminal neutrinos, violations of Lorentz, any one of these things would, I think, just completely destroy this kind of picture. But it's not special to, I mean, you know, it's not saying string theory predicts there's, I mean, it is saying string theory predicts there's no, or whatever, string theory is quantum field theory, so it predicts that there's no, that these crazy things don't happen. This is very important, by the way, just a zeroth order point. You know, as a physicist, as a theorist, you have an incredible power because you know things that are actually true about the world. And that means that you also know things that cannot possibly be true about the world. It isn't that everything goes. I mean, the whole history of our subject is that fewer and fewer things go. And there are more and more constraints that we learn about. And that gives us really lots and lots of power. You don't have to be afraid, and you certainly don't have to be ready to drop this spectacular theoretical framework at the drop of a hat. Experiments that have radical, strange-seeming outcomes are almost always wrong. And theories are almost always right. That's why it's so awesome to be a theorist. I'm sorry if there's experimentalists in the audience, but it's true. There's very, very few very remarkable radical experiments that completely topple standard theories. They occur, but it doesn't happen every day. Much, much more often are there wrong experiments that claim to topple the existing theoretical framework. So trust theory. You know, we have these incredible tools at our disposal that our intellectual ancestors worked very hard to hand us, and you know they're not to be thrown aside at the drop of a hat.
Nima,
more on, sir.
I guess you're tired. We are all tired, but
no, I'm fine.
I still want to pick up a little on this social conflict that you mentioned.
Yes.
I did live in the 80s, so to me, it probably matters more than it does to you.
Yes.
I can bet.
All sorts of terrible things.
I can bet.
Yeah, right.
I can bet about that. Right. I think, however, it seemed as if you meant that there should have been no tension because at the end we are working on the same subject, more
now
or less.
There's no tension. Back then, I could easily see that there was tension, and there was, and it made sense.
And yeah. I think the point is, I just want to emphasize it. Maybe you probably meant this, or maybe you don't. Let's see. That the issue is not so often what we really work on, but how we go about that. You see, there was a deep disagreement in that era between some of us that thought that if we wanted to understand a neutrino, for example, what's the origin of its mass, whether it has a mass, then we thought we should think about neutrino, study neutrino, look at the parameter space, pursue it. Not your string friend or enemy would tell you, no, don't do that. Why are you wasting your time? It's going to come out of my theory. And it doesn't matter what's going to come out because it's there.
Yeah.
And actually it got worse because you came up with a solution. Maybe describe the even phenomenon of nature. They said you should be worried because it didn't fit with the yeah, whatever the background is. So right. There was a real tension and yeah. a real dispute. It may come back. I think this is a profound issue, how we go about...
I think that there was that, and it was there to the extent that string theorists back then believed the answer would be unique. If you really believe the answer is going to be unique, then you believe that it may be a more efficient route to the solution to try to guess it. Now, I personally was not, I wasn't around in the 80s, but when I entered the field, this was not the direction I went in myself. So, I mean, I was on your side.
Thank you. Let's see.
I never believed the answer was going to be unique. And perhaps that's one of the reasons why I have such an easy time letting go of it. I never, ever thought the answer was going to be unique. And so I thought that attitude amongst string theorists was insane. What it seems to me, what seems now is that attitude was wrong. It's very plausibly wrong. It's possible, you know, there are caveats to all of it. It's possible in some roundabout way it might all come back and might all be unique. It seems wildly implausible right now, although again, we don't know. But on the other hand, much more important than this social feeling, though, is this basic intellectual point that it's not like one group of people was charging ahead to some vast generalization of quantum field theory while the other group of people was lazily sitting around, sitting on their asses with their tools that they had, trying to make predictions for the next level of phenomenon. That may have been pretty close to sociologically what was going on, okay? But as a matter of fact, they're the same theoretical structure. You know, we could say the people playing with string theory were just playing with absolutely incredible technicolor theories. They had no idea, but they're working with these absolutely stupendous, strongly coupled theories that have these incredible phenomena in them. And it's really important that there's this one theoretical framework. I think that's why this correspondence has had such a healing and unifying effect, not just between model builders and string theorists, but really as it fans out to having impact on so much of the rest of physics, is that a mark of a great set of ideas is that they do things that the proponents or the detractors, wouldn't imagine that it would do, and in very surprising ways ends up linking people together. But anyway, it's also, since it was a sociological comment, let me just end as a sociological statement, the large-scale war, to the extent that it existed, which was never really so much of so large-scale, but anyway, it's just gone. I mean, there is one big, very happy family, and it's great, and it's wonderful that it's actually physics that brought that about.
Okay. I'll stop for a while teasing. This is time to prove unification of the old
stuff. Well, as I said, if David Gross was in this room, he would get up and give all of us a talking to. Okay, so there are people who believe, and he has good reasons. There are very good reasons that there are reasons to believe. I deliberately didn't talk about this in great detail about this picture of 10 to the 500 vacuum and all these things because we're going to talk about it a little bit more later, perhaps. I didn't want to talk about it so much today, but this picture is not firmly mathematically theoretically established. And it's possible that there are subtle inconsistencies. It's possible that there's only one consistent cosmology, if not one approximate vacuum. All sorts of things are possible. But I'm not making a firm statement. I'm saying that to me and to many people, this idea that there is a unique low-energy manifestation of this theory just seems wildly, wildly implausible. If it turns out to be true, it'll be another incredible trick that this theory pulled that many, many people didn't expect.
Very good. Okay. Thank you very much, Nima.